the living worth it now.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Covenant of Grace Ministries YouTube channel. I am Reverend Steve Williams, Jr., and I want to send a warm welcome to all of my Covenant of Grace family, friends, and guests who are joining us today. We thank you for watching today's message, and we appreciate your support for the kingdom of God. As you all know, we are a community of saints, and we are kingdom partners. And we all can impact the lives of others by us continuing to renew our minds and transform our lives every day so that others can see Jesus Christ in us. And when we do that, it enables us to draw others to Christ. And that's what we want to do. And once we draw those people to Christ, we want them to do the same for others. So we just appreciate your continued support and partnership and helping us do that. Amen. All right. We're going to go ahead and begin our message for today. We are in week three of our teaching series that's entitled Applying the Divine Power of the Cross into Our Lives. And on last week, we talked about our focus was on Jesus Christ, the person of the cross and his uniqueness. And we covered four proofs that support that Jesus Christ is Lord. And the first thing that we talked about on last week was about his first proof was around Jesus' pre-existence. And we talked about that Jesus existed before his earthly birth. And we looked at scriptures that supported that. The second proof that we talked about was that Jesus made himself equal to God. And we looked at Colossians chapter 1 to support this. And we said that Jesus took on human flesh for the purpose of making the invisible God visible to us. And then we transitioned to the third proof. And that third proof was in regards to Jesus and Jesus accepting worship from others. And we saw examples of Jesus accepting worship from his disciples, as well as other people as well. Even the demons recognized Jesus as Lord. So we saw examples of that. And then the fourth proof was around Jesus's membership in the Trinity. And we talked about what the Trinity is. The Trinity is three distinct yet co-equal persons who share the same divine substance. And we talked about God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we provided an illustration of a pretzel that tried to give us a picture of what the Trinity looks like. You know, those three individual circles that are part of that pretzel that's connected with that one piece of dough. So hopefully that illustration helped you gain a better understanding of the Trinity. And then we talked about Jesus's human side as the Son of Man. And we said, although Jesus was God, he experienced some of the same things that we experience as human beings. You know, when he was on the earth, he was tired, he was thirsty, he went to sleep, he expressed emotions, he had compassion, and he had a human soul and spirit. And although Jesus was fully human, he did not sin. And the reason why we said he did not sin is because Jesus did not possess a sin nature, because his Father was the Holy Spirit. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and not man. And then finally, we talked about Jesus being both fully God and fully man. And we talked about that hypostatic union. And we looked in Philippians chapter 2, where we saw Paul illustrate that Jesus emptied himself of his deity and poured into another form as a bondservant. And we said, Jesus, he made the choice to restrict his deity, his God side, in order to submit to the will of his Father. And because of Jesus's obedience to the cross, God placed him with the highest honor. And we said, that's why his name, as the scripture says, his name is above every name. Every name that's in heaven, on earth, or below the earth. And we know that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So if you haven't, had an opportunity to watch last week's message, please check it out on our YouTube channel. Today's message, we're going to be speaking on biblical prophecy, the biblical prophecy of Jesus Christ. Amen. So Jesus is the focal point of everything God is doing in the world. And because Jesus is the focal point, he has a significant influence in Bible prophecy. You see, Bible prophecy foretells the coming of Christ for the first time to be the Savior of the world, to be the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, and biblical prophecy for the second time, his second coming. When he comes again, he's going to come again to rule as king. And that's the line of Judah side of Jesus. And so we see biblical prophecy both in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And our objective in today's teaching is not to deal with every prophetic scripture concerning Jesus in the scriptures, but to show us, we want to show you that Jesus is the focus of Bible prophecy. And this makes his life, his death on the cross, and what it achieved, it is a matter of great importance. Amen. So I know a lot, as we go through these this teaching today, we're going to cover a lot of scriptures. And I know people may find themselves being a little bit bored at listening to scripture. But here's the thing. The more that we understand about God and who he is, the more we understand his motives, the more we understand his actions, and the more we understand his desires. And this applies to any relationship that we have with someone. And then this is personally what I've gained as I studied these scriptures and gotten a chance to meditate on them. Now I've gotten a better understanding of God's love for me personally, not only corporately, but personally, and how big he is and compared to my circumstances, my issues. He's bigger, as the song says, he is bigger than anything. And so hopefully you'll see this as we go through these scriptures. So let's go to our introduction. Jesus himself, he teaches about his significant role in prophecy during a walk that he has with two of his disciples after his resurrection in Luke chapter 24. And as I studied this passage over the past couple of weeks, I realized that in the past, I would read these verses, but I really didn't understand the significance of what occurred. And so in order to set up this title scripture, we're going to provide some context to what is taking place in Luke 24 as before we read verses 25 and 27. So this is what's taking place. Jerusalem is in disarray over Jesus, who had been crucified a few days earlier. And now it's Sunday, and there are reports that Jesus is alive again and his grave is empty. And so word is traveling through the grapevine. And then we see in this passage that there are two disciples of Jesus who are discussing these events as they are walking back to their home village of Emmaus. And as they walk together, Jesus approaches them and he begins walking with them. But the two disciples, they were prevented from recognizing Jesus. You see, their unbelieving words about Jesus's resurrection was blinding their eyes in the natural from actually seeing who Jesus really was, you know, who he really is. So Jesus, he asked them, he said, why are you disputing why are y'all having this dispute? Even though he knew what they were disputing about, he asked them this question. So Cleophas one of the disciples that he was walking with responded and said, "Are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who doesn't know what has happened over the past 3 days?" And so Cleophas and the other disciple, they tell Jesus about himself, right? And how he was a mighty prophet and a great teacher. And they shared how the religious leaders and the rulers sentenced Jesus to death and crucified him. And they were so hoping that Jesus would be the one who would redeem Israel. And then they shared that this morning, some women had gone to Jesus's tomb and they found it empty, and how some other disciples have gone out to verify their story. So the two men, they were really disappointed, and they didn't think the reports of Jesus's resurrection was true. And their lack of faith had caused them to either forget or to misunderstand the prophetic word concerning Jesus, the Messiah. So Jesus responds to his disciples in Luke 24, verses 25 through 27. I'm gonna read it. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Wasn't it necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted for them the things concerning himself in all the scriptures." Wow. See, these two disciples, they were confused and they were discouraged because things didn't work out the way they should have. They thought God's plan had backfired, but Jesus came and he brought some clarity to that situation. But here's the enlightening part that I hope that we see in verse 27. Jesus took the time with his disciples to enlighten them by using the Old Testament to explain his coming and his ministry. Do we see that Jesus led these men through the Holy Scriptures to give them an understanding of who he is, to give them an understanding of what was happening and how they were to perceive the events they had just experienced? And church, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we need to take this same approach with the people that we disciple. We need, for those people that we're discipling, we need to take our time and spend time with them going through the word of God so that they have clarity and they have understanding. That's what Jesus did. And this is the thing. People may not see this as such, but what Jesus did for these two disciples in this example, in this passage, that was an act of love, church. It was an act of love. And here's another key point. Jesus taught from the scriptures that talked about him. I'm going to say that again. Jesus taught from the scriptures that talked about him. So we don't know specifically what Jesus showed the disciples, but we know that he taught them about himself so that they had knowledge and understanding, and that in itself is the goodness of God. Okay? So studying prophecy. When we study prophecy, it's like riding in a spacecraft orbiting the earth. You know, sometimes, church, we're able to see things more clearly when we see them from a distance. We get a full picture. You ever been on an airplane? You can see the landscape. You get a better picture of the landscape when you're riding in an airplane about 30,000 feet in the air. You know, it's difficult to see the true landscape when you're inhabiting the earth. So on that spacecraft, you know, when you're orbiting the earth, it's easy to see that the earth is round because you're looking at the earth from a distance. You're not inhabiting the earth. You're outside the earth And so you can see that the earth is round, but it's difficult to see the earth is round, when you're inhabiting it, right? And the scripture that talks, in scripture, I think it's Revelations 19 and 10, it says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So in order for the prophetic word of God to become real to us, church, we have to be willing to get on board God's spacecraft, okay, and take the trip. We got to be willing to get on his spacecraft and go on that trip with him. We must have a willingness to pursue that which God has spoken, because we are exercising faith that God's word is true. So if we are to understand the prophetic word of God, we must be willing to give God not only our heads or our minds, but we also must give him our hearts, church, and allow the Holy Spirit, our divine teacher, to reveal to us the knowledge and the understanding of God's word. So let's go back to our passage in Luke 24. After Jesus spent some time with these two disciples, he vanished. And the two disciples, instead of going to Emmaus, they walked back to Jerusalem, and they shared their experience with the other disciples. And while they were sharing their experience with them, Jesus came into the room, and he conversed with this larger group, and he started teaching the larger group. And so we're going to read this passage in Luke 24, 44 through 47. He told them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. You see that, church? He also said to them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead the third day, and repentance for forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning at Jerusalem." Church, the prophecy of Jesus Christ focuses on the birth, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. And so, church, what we're going to do in our teachings today is we're going to cover these prophecies around his birth, his death, and his resurrection. Also today, we're going to talk about prophecy and typology, and how these two principles are linked together. And then we're going to finally cover some Old Testament typology when it comes to sacrifices, when it comes to the tabernacle, the Old Testament tabernacle. And we're going to talk about other types that we see in the wilderness that connect to Jesus Christ. So let's begin. We're going to start by talking about prophecies of Jesus's birth. And as we go through this, these prophecies of Jesus' birth, these scriptures of prophecies that are declared are scriptures that we covered on last week. So I'm not going to go into real detail with them. The first one is found in Micah 5 and 2. And we use this scripture to talk about Jesus' existence before his earthly birth. But one of the things we spoke about in Micah 5 and 2 is it gives the birthplace of Jesus, Bethlehem. And so you see this prophecy. It took place. Micah was written, I guess, this prophecy was given 800 years before Christ was born. And we see this prophecy being filled in Luke chapter 2, verses 10 through 2. And this is when the angel spoke to the shepherds. It says, "But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the city of David was born for you, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be the sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped tightly in cloth and lying in a manger.'" The city of David represents Bethlehem. David's hometown was Bethlehem, and they called Bethlehem the city of David. So we see prophecy being fulfilled in this example about Jesus Christ's birth. Now, the next example is another example. Isaiah 7 and 14, it talks about a virgin conceiving and having a son. And we see this prophecy being fulfilled in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. verses 20 through 22. And this is concerning Joseph and how Joseph finds out about the birth of Jesus. It says, the birth of Jesus Christ came about this way. After his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, it was discovered before they came together that she was pregnant from the Holy Spirit. But after he had considered these things, an angel of the Lord appeared to him, and that's Joseph in the dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what has been conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Now, all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. So we see that prophecy being fulfilled. All right, here's another one. There's a bonus one. Hosea chapter 11, verse 1. And it says, when Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt, I called my son. So we know that the Israelites were slaves in Egypt in the Old Testament. We saw that God brought them out after being in slavery for over 400 years. But now this scripture in Hosea not only speaks about that, but it gives prophetic, gives a prophecy about Jesus. And if we read Matthew 2 and 15, we'll see what has taken place. And this particular scripture, this is after the wise men visit Jesus. He was a young child. They visit Joseph and Mary as well as Jesus, and they bring him the gifts. You know, they bring him the gold, the frankincense, then the myrrh. And after they leave, it says, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in the dream, saying, get up, take the child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child to kill him. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and escaped to Egypt. He stayed there until Herod's death, so that what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet might be fulfilled. Out of Egypt, I called my son. So do we see that prophecy being fulfilled here? Jesus was, God called Jesus out of Egypt when Herod died, because Herod was out to kill him, and Herod ended up killing thousands and thousands of babies because he was trying to get to Jesus. And so God had spoke, that was a prophetic word spoken about that in Hosea 11:1. So, hopefully that gives us some good examples of prophecies of Christ's birth. We're going to go on and look at some prophecies of Christ's death. First one, prophecy declared was in Isaiah 53 verses 3 through 5 and verse 7. It says, he was despised and rejected by men, a man of suffering, who knew what his sickness was. He was like someone people turned away from. He was despised and we didn't value him. Yet he himself bore our sickness and he carried our pains. But we in turn regarded him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our rebellion, crushed because of our iniquities. Punishment for our peace was on him, and we are healed by his wounds. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter and like a sheep silent before her shears, he did not open his mouth. This is a prophetic word about Jesus Christ. And this prophecy was fulfilled as Peter writes in 1 Peter 2, verses 21 through 24. And he's a witness because he was there with Jesus. He said, for you were called to this because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He did not commit sin and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was insulted, he did not insult in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that having died to sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed, for you were like sheep going astray, but you have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. All right, so Peter's using this prophetic word to encourage the believers to continue to persevere when dealing with suffering. Here's another example in Psalms 22, 6 through 8. It says, but I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by people. Everyone who sees me mocks me. They sneer and they shake their heads. He relies on the Lord's. Let him save him. Let the Lord rescue him, since he takes pleasure in him. This is a prophetic word that happened to Jesus when he was being crucified and going through his part of his, and it's found in Luke 23, verses 35 to 36. It says, the people stood watching. Even the leaders were scoffing. He saved others. Let him save himself if this is God's Messiah, the chosen one. The soldiers also mocked him. They came offering him sour wine and said, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. We see the prophecy being fulfilled regarding Jesus' crucifixion and his death. Let's move on to another example. Psalms 22, verse 14, 16, and 18. And it talks about specific things that happened as when Jesus was on the cross. It says in verse 14, I'm poured out like water and all my bones are disjointed. My heart is like wax melting within me, for dogs have surrounded me. A gang of evildoers has closed in on me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. People look and stare at me. They divided my garments among themselves and they cast lots for my clothing. We see this prophecy about Jesus' clothes being casted by lots. In Matthew 27:35, it says, after crucifying him, they divided his clothes by casting lots. And then we see some other prophecy from Psalm 22 being fulfilled as we look at John 19, verses 34 through 36. It says, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. Okay. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows he is telling the truth. For these things happen so that the scripture would be fulfilled. And it says in the last part of verse 36, not one of his bones will be broken. That was prophesied right there in Psalms 22. Although he was crucified, none of Jesus' bones were broken. They were disjointed, but none of them were broken. All right, here's another prophecy. We're going to talk about Christ's resurrection and some prophecy that's tied to his resurrection. Psalm 16, verses 8 through 10. It says, I always let the Lord guide me because he is at my right hand and I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My body also rests securely, for you will not abandon me to Sheol. You will not allow your faithful one to see decay. So this prophecy is fulfilled in Acts chapter 2, verses 29 through 32, as Peter is preaching on the day of Pentecost. He says, brothers and sisters, I can confidently speak to you about the patriarch David. He is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him to seat one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke concerning the resurrection of the Messiah. He was not abandoned in Hades, and his flesh did not experience decay. God has raised this Jesus. We are all witnesses of this. Amen. Now, this next slide is going to show us some additional prophecies, and these prophecies are given. Jesus himself prophesied his own resurrection, and he gives is the first three verses that you see are things he Jesus prophecies that he declared to his disciples. The first example is in Matthew 16:21. The second one is in Matthew 17:3. I'll read Matthew 20 verses 17 through 19. It says, while going up to Jerusalem, Jesus took the 12 disciples aside privately and said to them on the way, see, we are going up to Jerusalem. The Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. They will hand him over to the Gentiles to be mocked, flogged, and crucified. And on the third day, he will be raised. In addition to Jesus prophesying to the disciples, he also prophesied his resurrection to the unbelieving Jews in the presence of the disciples in John chapter 2, in this verses 18 through 22. And the scripture talks about the temple being raised in 3 days, and that temple represents Jesus. So if you get a chance in your Bible study, please read that and to get that prophetic word that did get fulfilled through Jesus Christ. So we have covered all of the prophetic, the prophecies that were fulfilled about regarding Jesus' birth, his death, and his resurrections. So I hope all of these scriptures help us to see the uniqueness of Christ in prophecy. So when we see all of his fulfilled prophecies in his first coming, hopefully this gives us confidence about the prophecies that talk about his second coming. Amen. And we know in his second coming, he's coming back to rule as king. And in addition, we should have confidence in all that Christ has accomplished for us on the cross to aid us in operating boldly in the abundant life that he has given through his life, his death, and his resurrection. Amen. All right. So now we're going to move on and start. We're going to talk about prophecy and typology. Somebody's like, what in the world is typology? Typology is doctrine that ties both the Old and New Testament by using images or pictures or what they call types. So what happens is we use images from the Old Testament that foreshadow the person in the ministry of Jesus Christ. So typology is basically an Old Testament image revealing and pointing forward to a New Testament truth. So just as God gave us a prophetic map of the Old Testament scriptures that point us to Jesus, he also gives us images. He also gives us pictures in the Old Testament that point us to Jesus and reminds us of him, okay? Typology provides an Old Testament image of a New Testament reality. And many of the Old Testament ceremonies, the regulations, the rituals, and even the people were types or images of Christ in that they illustrate various aspects of him. So what we're going to do, and I just want to give you a quick example. In the Gospels, John the Baptist calls Jesus the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. When John the Baptist, when he says this in the scriptures, in the Gospels, he was using an Old Testament image or type and saying that Jesus is the fulfillment of this image. So all of those sacrificial lambs offered in Israel in the Old Testament to temporarily cover their sins was a picture of the Lamb of God who would come and offer up his blood to take away the sins of the world forever. Amen. And I just want to share a point that Pastor Spradley always teaches us, and it's about the Word of God. And it stuck with me. He says, when we study the Word of God, we must study it in its entirety. We can't just look at the Old Testament only. We can't just look at the New Testament only, because when we do that, it limits our perspective. It doesn't provide us that full picture. You know, so if we focus just on the Old Testament, we don't have a understanding that Old Testament was fulfilled in the New Testament. Okay, so and then when we only focus in on the New Testament, we won't understand a lot of the New Testament, because a good portion of the New Testament explains it applies, and it fulfills what was written in the Old Testament. So this is a scripture, Colossians 2, 16 and 17 talks about this. It says, and this is Paul speaking to the church of Colossians, says, therefore, don't let anyone judge you in regard to food or drink or in the matter of a festival or a new moon or Sabbath day. Sounds like people are placing a lot of focus on rituals and ceremonies and things that people were eating instead of focusing on relationship. They were tying themselves back to the old covenant. He said, these are a shadow of what was to come. The substance is Christ. The substance is Christ. He said, the things of the Old Testament were a mere shadow, but the substance belongs to Christ. So here's a question for you, for all of us. Would we rather hug a shadow of a loved one or the real thing? I'm going to say that again. Would we rather hug a shadow of a loved one or the real thing? I know some of us haven't seen a lot of our family members for a long time. Would you rather hug their shadow or would you rather hug the real thing, the person themselves? Amen. I'm going to go Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell on you. Ain't nothing like the real thing, baby. Ain't nothing like the real thing. That's what we're talking about. So when we embrace the Old Testament only, it's like embracing the shadow, right? But to embrace Jesus Christ, the person, through both the Old and New Testament and in its entirety, is to embrace the real thing, church. The reality behind the image. All right. So the author of the book of Hebrews focuses on the fulfillment of the old covenant. And we're going to look at that scripture on our next slide. It's Hebrews 7. We're going to look at verses 18 through 20, verse 22 as well. And then we're going to jump to chapter 10 and look at verses 11 and 12. It says, yes, the old requirement about the priesthood was set aside because it was weak and useless, for the law never made anything perfect. But now we have confidence in a better hope through which we draw near to God. This new system, this new covenant, this covenant of grace was established with a solemn oath. Aaron's descendants became priests without such an oath. Because of this oath, Jesus is the one who guarantees this better covenant with God. Under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sins. But our high priest, Jesus Christ, offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for our sins. Good for all time. Thank you, Jesus. Then he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand. Yes. You see, the Old Testament brought a cumbersome way to live that involved a complicated system of rituals and sacrifices. And as Pastor Spradley has taught us, he says the law is a diagnostic tool that it pointed us to Christ. And it helps us recognize, hey, I'm a sinner and I need a savior. I need Jesus. I need Jesus to help me. And Jesus Christ, he fulfilled the Old Testament law, which provided us a better and more excellent way to put us in right standing with God the Father. Amen. We don't have to sacrifice lambs. We don't have to sacrifice goats to cover our sins anymore. Jesus's one sacrifice took care of all that for us. And all that we have to do is repent of our sins and our dead works, and we place our faith in him, and our sins, past, present, and future, are gone. He wipes them clean. He does that for us. Amen. So let's talk about some Old Testament typology, and we're going to focus here on sacrifices and how these sacrifices point to Jesus Christ. So there were five basic sacrifices under the Old Testament law: the burnt offering, the grain offering, the peace offering, sin offering, and the trespass offering. So The first three sacrifices were associated with dedication to God. And Jesus fulfilled the burnt offering, the grain offering, the peace offering. Jesus fulfilled these offerings through his life of total submission and complete obedience to God the Father. And the scripture talks about this in Hebrews 10 and 7, when the scripture says, Jesus came on earth to do his Father's will. If Jesus had disobeyed God once, if just once, he would have disqualified himself from being our Lord and Savior. All right. Jesus is unique among all people that walk the face of his earth because of his complete and perfect obedience. Amen. The last two sacrifices, the sin offering and the trespass offering, were associated with atonement for sin. And we recognize that Jesus Christ's death fulfilled these sacrifices. And this is given to us in Romans 3, 24 through 26. It says, yet God in his grace freely makes us right in his sight. He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty for our sins. For God presented Jesus as the sacrifice for sin. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. This sacrifice showed that God was being fair when he held back and did not punish those who sinned in times past, but he was looking ahead and including them in what he would do in this present time. God did this to demonstrate his righteousness, for he himself is fair and just, and he makes sinners right in his sight when they believe in Jesus. All right, this covers the typology that's associated with sacrifices. Our next typology that we're going to look at is the tabernacle typology. And we're going to, this study is going to give us a picture of how the tabernacle, that the temple where God dwelled, how different those different images in the temple in that tabernacle are linked to Jesus Christ. We know that in Exodus, God provided specific details on how he wanted his house to be built. He gave those detailed instructions, and these images point us to Christ. We're going to share with you seven examples of the way Jesus fulfilled the tabernacle typology. The first example is the door of the temple. And we know that there was only that one door in the temple. And Jesus says in John 14 and 6, he says, I am the way, I am that door, the truth and the life. No one can come through the Father unless they go through Jesus. Amen. The second example is with the brass altar. The brass altar is where the sacrifices took place. And in Mark 10, 45, Jesus says, I came to give my life as a ransom or sacrifice for many. So that brass altar links to Jesus because he gave his life as a ransom for many. Amen. All right. The next item in the tabernacle is the light in the tabernacle. And in John 8 and 12, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. Jesus is the light of the world. That light in the tabernacle represents Jesus. The next example is the bread on the table in the tabernacle. All right. John 6 and 48 says, Jesus tells us that I am the bread of life. So Jesus represents the bread of life, and he is our provider and gives us that spiritual bread that we need and our physical bread each and every day. He is our source. The sixth example is the veil that was hung in the tabernacle. I think for those of you who don't remember, the veil separated the outer chambers from the inner chambers in the tabernacle. And we know within the inner chambers that lied the holies of holies, and that was where the presence of God dwelt. And because of that veil signified that full access to God was not yet achieved. But we see in Matthew 27, verse 5, it says, when Jesus died, the veil in the temple was torn in half. So when Jesus died and fulfilled that prophecy in the scripture, that veil was torn, which provided us the ability to have access to God at that point when we place our faith in Jesus Christ. And then Hebrews 10 and 20 also says that the veil represented Christ's body, which give those who place their faith in him full access to God. All right. And so the last example that we're talking about, that we'll talk that speaking around the tabernacle, is the Ark of God, the Ark of God with the mercy seat. And we know this is where the blood of the sacrificial lamb was sprinkled to atone. You know, that was for the atonement for sins. And so in John 10 and 15, Jesus says, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. So that Ark of God with the mercy seat is linked to Jesus because Jesus laid down his life. His blood was poured out for the atonement of our sins forever. Amen. All right. So our last point that we'll talk typology lesson that we'll talk about was our examples of Old Testament typology that's found in the wilderness. And the first example that we'll see is the rock. And we see the rock mentioned in Numbers chapter 20, verse 11. This was a passage where we saw the children of Israel, they were in the wilderness and they became very hungry and thirsty, and they were kind of getting on Moses' nerve, and because they were complaining, God had given instruction to Moses to speak to the rock, and the rock was going to pour out the water. But Moses struck the rock, and when he struck the rock, it produced enough water for the entire nation, not only the people, but their livestock as well. And so Christ serves as our spiritual rock. And we see an example of this in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 4. It says, all of them ate of the same spiritual food, and all of them drank the same spiritual water, for they drank from the spiritual rock that traveled with them. And that rock was Christ. So this Jesus Christ is our provision. He not only gave water to his people in the wilderness, but he also provides us spiritual water to quench our thirst. And the good thing about Jesus' spiritual water is free refills, church, free refills. I love a place that offers free refills. So it's all good. Second example that we'll talk about is manna. Manna, I know we remember manna. This is one of another images that were we see in Exodus when we in the wilderness, Exodus chapter 10, verses 14 and 15. And we know that manna was the bread that fell from the heavens to feed the children of Israel. And it was that manna was an image that pointed us to, that points us to Jesus Christ. And if we go to John chapter 6, verses 35 and 38, Jesus says this. He says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. And verse 38 says, for I have come down from heaven to do the will of God who sent me, not to do my own will. So the manna represents the bread of life, which is Jesus Christ. Our last example that we see is the bronze serpent. The bronze serpent, we see this illustration, this image in Numbers chapter 21, verses 4 through 9. And in this particular passage, there was some judgment God placed on the children of Israel for their pattern of disobedience. And what happened is that God allowed poisonous snakes to come into the camp of the children of Israel. And many of them were bitten by these poisonous snakes. And God showed mercy and told Moses, you know, I'm going to save my people. He said, well, you know what you need to do. He gave him instructions. He said, I want you to make a bronze serpent and place it on a pole. And he says, anyone who looks at that bronze serpent on that pole will live. And so this image of the bronze serpent is linked to Jesus in John chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. And Jesus is speaking and he says, "And as Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life." So when he says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, you know, that bronze serpent was an image of the type of sacrifice Jesus would make for our sins, church. That lifting up means to be lifted up on the cross. You know, just as the serpent was lifted up for deliverance from death, so to be delivered required an act of faith. In the wilderness, you know, a person had to believe that the serpent, that bronze serpent, would deliver them first. But not only that, that person had to not only believe that that bronze serpent would deliver him, but they also had to look at it in order to be delivered. Amen. That was their act of faith. And in order for us to be born again, we must believe in our heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. But the scripture says we also have to confess with our mouths as well. And so we have to speak it. That's an act of faith in order to be delivered from the lake of fire. So these three examples of Old Testament typology in the wilderness all link to Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. So here's our closing points. Jesus is the Lamb of God, prophesied to come, but he's also the perfect fulfillment of every Old Testament typology. He's the Lamb of God, prophesied to come, and he's also the perfect fulfillment of every Old Testament typology. Second point we want to make is that Jesus Christ's life, his death, and his resurrection are all we need to overcome and persevere through any situation or any circumstance that life may bring to us. Amen. Once we come to understand and have knowledge about who he is and the things that he's done for us, it just makes him that much bigger than our circumstance, that much bigger than our trial, that much bigger than our tribulation. So church, our challenge, our charge today is let's begin to walk in this truth in our daily lives. Amen. Amen. Church, we're going to pick up next time on the death of Jesus Christ and what Jesus' death means to us as his disciples. We appreciate you watching today, and I recommend that you go back and rewatch this message today and review some of the scriptures that have been listed in these slides on this message. There's quite a lot of information that was shared, and you may not have absorbed it all in this one sitting, in this one teaching. So I encourage you to go back and listen to this message again so you can meditate on these scriptures and gain even more nuggets than you receive in your first sitting, church. So important to us to continue to meditate on God's word and grasp and pick up more and more knowledge and understanding of him. Amen. We appreciate your continued support for our ministry, whether it's watching the messages on our YouTube channel, whether it's through your prayers, your feedback, your seed gifts that you provide. All of these forms of support, church, they are vital to the kingdom of God. And we just want you to know how much we appreciate you. Amen. All right. So we're going to take this time to open the door of the church. If there's anyone who's watching that hasn't accepted Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior, or they're not sure, we want to give you this opportunity to pray this prayer of salvation and welcome you into the family. Amen. And Lord God, I come to you today repenting of my dead works. I place my faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for raising from the dead to give me an abundant life. Come into my heart, Lord, by your Holy Spirit to lead and live in me. Thank you, Father, that right now I am born again as a fresh new child of God, forever set free by your truth. Amen. Welcome to the family, my brother and my sisters. All right. We're going to close out with our benediction, and it's found in Ephesians 1, 17 through 19. We pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, our glorious Father, would give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. We pray that the eyes of our hearts may be enlightened so that we may know what is the hope of your calling, what is the wealth of your glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of your power toward us who believe, according to the mighty working of your strength. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you, everyone. God bless you, and we will see you on next week. Take care.
Your voice and say